Listen-only mode.
Welcome to today's webinar, The How of the 10% Entrepreneur, 10 Steps to Becoming an Entrepreneur Without Quitting Your Day Job, co-sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association and the Georgetown Entrepreneurship Alliance. My name is Kara Tyrone, Associate Director of Alumni Career Services, and our presenter today is Patrick McGinnis, venture capitalist and published author. Before we start, I'd like to share just a few reminders for the audience. Questions are welcome throughout today's webinar. Simply type them in the question area as you have them in real time, and I will filter all questions to Patrick, and he will answer as they come through. Remember that no question is silly. Every question is worth asking. Now is your chance to hear from an expert in the field. Please note that today's presentation will be recorded and made available to all registrants within 3 days on our YouTube channel, which I have also hyperlinked for you in the chat area. And finally, if you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me also via the chat area. Without further ado, I'd like to go ahead and introduce our presenter. Patrick McGinnis is a venture capitalist and private equity investor who is the author of the international best-selling book, The 10% Entrepreneur. He has appeared on MSNBC, CNN en Español, BBC Radio, and has been featured in the Financial Times, the Daily Mail, Fast Company, Fortune, and Forbes. A graduate of Harvard Business School and Georgetown University, Patrick is known for coining the term FOMO, or fear of missing out, which was added to the Oxford Dictionary in 2013. He apologizes profusely to any of you who live in a constant FOMO. Patrick, we're eager to get started, so now I will go ahead and turn it over to you.
Thank you very much, Kara, and thanks for everybody for joining today. As Kara mentioned, I'm a Georgetown School of Foreign Service graduate of the class of 98, so shout out to anybody from the class of 98 that's joining us today. And I've done this before. I've had a chance to spend some time with you before in a previous webcast, but I'm coming in today with a slightly different approach. I wanted to get more into details of how to actually become a 10% entrepreneur, and I also am coming at this having now, with the book, been out talking to lots of people, so I have new stories, and I've learned a lot from the readers in terms of what the experiences are actually putting this into practice, and of course I will be sharing my own personal experiences. As we go through this, I encourage you to ask lots of questions. As was mentioned, there are no bad questions at all, and I love hearing questions that are creative or outside of the norm, and I'm very happy to also hear criticisms, and if you do disagree, please let me know, and let's talk about it. I really love digging into this and finding how we can make this as relevant to all of you as possible and how engaging this can be. And I want to let you know that about halfway through, I will stop to answer some questions and take some questions, so please do contribute them, and then we'll do some more towards the end. I just want to start here with the ways you can reach me, because I really endeavor to be in touch with people and available for your questions as we go along. So you can find much more at patrickmcginnis.com, which is my site, and we will be relaunching that shortly, so you're going to have a much fuller site. But in the meantime, we've got a great blog, we've got lots of resources on top of the ones that I'm going to be talking about today. We've also, if you would like to take a quiz about how to be a 10% entrepreneur, you can do so, and you can also get a free chapter of the book, so you can check out what you think, and if you like what you see, you could consider buying it, and it's all linked through there. You can also reach me at info@patrickmcginnis. You can get me at the 10% Entrepreneur Facebook page, on Twitter, Instagram, and even Snapchat. And the book is obviously available in English all over the world, and it just came out in Spanish and Korean recently. So it makes a great gift to any Spanish-speaking or Korean-speaking friends. And with that, I just want to dive right into the question here, which is, what is a 10% entrepreneur? So I'm going to talk today about how to actually do this, but without talking about what it means to be a 10% entrepreneur and sort of how you do that in a high level sense, I think we won't have the context. So I do want to spend a bit of time explaining the concept here, and I want to tie it into the events of the last couple of days, because this whole election has obviously been very surprising, and you know, you may have gotten the candidate you wanted, or you may have gone for a different candidate, but I think we can all agree that this whole election cycle has been full of surprises, in just a non-stop deluge of surprises on a weekly basis of crazy things happening. And I have found that when there are lots of things that are unexpected happening around me, I just personally can feel stressed in a way that I might not otherwise. And in fact, the whole reason that I came up with this idea was as a result of the financial crisis in 2008. So I was working on Wall Street for a big company, AIG, which blew up overnight. My stock in the company fell 97%. And I felt a real lack of autonomy in my life. I really felt like I was sort of out of control, or that the world was beyond my control. And I found it very stressful and upsetting. And so it's funny, now that I've been doing this, I've been working on part-time entrepreneurship on the side as a 10% entrepreneur over the last 5 years, I've been surprised at how that actually is quite comforting in times of change. So for example, when Brexit happened and the markets were somewhat, I would say somewhat expected to be very full of turmoil, I remember thinking how glad I was that I had built this group of entrepreneurial ventures on the side that belong to me, because when there is turmoil and when there is change and when there are unexpected events, you never know how they'll play out in your career, and you want to be diversified. So I just would offer to you as a leading thought the idea that this can be a really great way for you to create a diversification in your life that will help you when things may be surprising or shocking or not go as you had anticipated they might go, and allow you to impose some control over that. And with that, I want to explain what a 10% entrepreneur does. It's somebody who is somebody who spends 10% of their time, and if possible, 10% of their money, investing, advising, and getting involved in new ventures. So it's somebody who has a full-time job, but uses their resources, whether that's their intellect or their time or their capital, to do things outside of their day job in order to get all sorts of benefits. And this is really only possible because of technological changes that have come into effect over the last 10 years or 15 years that have made it so much easier to start a company. So there, I have on the slide sort of the driver of why you can actually do this today. And it's really two secular trends that we can look to. The first is that the cost of starting a company has gone down dramatically. So you have on the slide there, you can see all kinds of tools that many of us use all the time, whether it's Google Drive, Squarespace, 99 Designs to get a logo designed, Gmail, Skype for international or local communication, your iPhone, Amazon Web Services, MailChimp, all of the Facebook and social media and other things that allow you to market a business very inexpensively or free. And so all of these things taken together, first of all, many of them didn't even exist 10 years ago, but also they have made it much cheaper to start and run a business. So when I started my career as a venture capitalist right after Georgetown in 99, the cost of building an internet company was in the hundreds of thousands of dollars just to get the site up. And now you can build a site that's very similar to the ones that people built back then with the same functionality for basically free thanks to sites like Squarespace. The cost of all of the storage, right? A gigabyte of space cost about $8,000 less than 15 years ago. Now it's basically free. And so obviously with Skype and all the social media, we're able to connect with people and market our businesses to them basically for free. And it's tremendous help to somebody who wants to start a business part-time or full-time. You just have far more flexibility and you need far less capital to do so. At the same time, this has really enabled a great growth in angel investment in startups. So there are over 300,000 angels in the United States, investing $24 billion in nearly 80,000 companies as of 2013. And so we've seen this interesting democratization of the way that companies raise money. And so you see many opportunities around you and the people you know in your community to actually invest in startups. And so there has been this huge bubble in investing, growth in investing. I don't want to say bubble because there's lots of great companies in there. And that has allowed many more people to consider maybe getting involved in entrepreneurial ventures, perhaps as an investor or in starting something or raising money from people. And just in general, it's been an important source of fuel for the entire entrepreneurial ecosystem, both in the United States and overseas. And so, you know, we have over 300 angel investment groups in the United States, but they're all over the world. I've been lucky enough to visit with a bunch of people in different places. I was just in Kenya a couple weeks ago. There's stuff going on there. There's things going on in Rwanda. I've met with groups in Latin America and Jamaica and Europe. And in the book, I actually profile an angel investment group in China. So this is global. It's gone global, and this is a widely accepted form of getting lots of different people to support startups. Now, that's all good, but at the same time, you know, I do want to be very honest about the reality of entrepreneurship, and I talk about this because if you think about all of these trends that I've highlighted, the fact that it's never been cheaper to start a company, the fact that all these people are investing, you might think to yourself, well, I should just quit my job and start a business, and that may be the right answer for you, but it may not be, and I'll tell you why. The reality is that if you look at the statistics, and there's a great study out of Harvard Business School by Professor Shikhar Ghosh that shows that when he looked at 2,000 startups and the outcomes of those startups over, I think, about a 10-year period, he found that 75% of startups do not generate the promised return, and 30 to 40% return nothing at all. And so there is this, obviously, a lot of excitement about entrepreneurship, and that's necessary, because if you can't get excited about putting in all the work that it takes to build a new business, then why are you there? However, I think there's also, I call it entrepreneurship Inc. There's an entire industry that has popped up to glamorize, sell, market, and convince everybody to be an entrepreneur, and I think that is unfortunately a very unhealthy and unsustainable way of thinking about entrepreneurship. You really need to have a clear eyes when you're going into doing something entrepreneurial. And so as a result, you think about all these changes and you think about all the excitement, but I would posit the best way to get involved with entrepreneurship is to actually become a 10% entrepreneur. And the reasons, and I give five here, are quite clear if you've had the chance to do this in real life, and I think they would become quite clear if you give this a try. The first one is downside protection, so it's diversification. It's the idea that when you work at a trillion-dollar company like I did at AIG, you still could be very well out of a job someday, and things may not go your way, office politics, macroeconomic uncertainty. There's just lots of things that can change the way that we work, and it's, if you think about it, how many people do you know have had smooth sailing their entire career? And therefore, creating diversification by building a portfolio of entrepreneurial activities in which you are a part of these businesses is a great way to diversify against the bet that you've made, that long-term bet you've made in your day job. Second is upside opportunity. It's the idea that, you know, you may be in a very stable job, but it's not that, even though you have a stable job and you may very well like it, doesn't mean that your eyes are closed to the opportunities around you. And so you may know people who are doing startups or other types of ventures that have huge opportunities for upside. And it's not necessary for you to watch from the sidelines. Why don't you try to get sort of involved and see how you can become part of this upside? Third is making life richer and more interesting. And I think about all of the people that I've met, all of the great entrepreneurs that I work with as a 10% entrepreneur. They teach me something. They make life more fun. I have a good friend who's got a big job on Wall Street. But when you meet him, what he wants to tell you about is how he's an investor in Sweetgreen and all the cool things that they've done and the upside, but also just being part of something amazing. Sweetgreen, if you don't know it, is a salad chain started by some Georgetown grads. It's probably my number one source of nutrition at this point. And imagine being part of something like that, something that's growing, that's changing the way that people live. It's very exciting. And it also allows you to leverage all the skills you've developed to do something, to reconnect with things that you may have done in the past. Maybe you were an entrepreneur, but you've gone into something more stable, or your company's grown to a point where it's no longer an entrepreneurial venture. Maybe you're one of those people who's always connecting people, and you start to wonder, you know, I spend all this time connecting people, but what do I get out of it? These 10% endeavors are all ways to get something and make your life richer and more interesting. The fourth is to learn what it means to be an entrepreneur. So lots of people, as I mentioned, are excited about entrepreneurship, but until you've done the work of an entrepreneur, you have no idea what it requires, what it's like, and even if you'll enjoy it. So by taking part in ventures on the side, working with other people, getting exposure to the upside and to the risks of entrepreneurship, you learn what it means, and if you ever want to do it, you go in with your eyes wide open. And finally, you can be more effective at your day job. So I have had the pleasure of speaking 3 times in the past 6 months at Google in different places around the world. And the reason why is because people forget that Google is I used to think of it like a startup, but it's not a startup. It's one of the largest companies in the world, depending on the day. And as a result, people who work there have actually, many of them have never been in an entrepreneurial environment. And learning how to think like an entrepreneur, as I said before, requires you to do the work of an entrepreneur. And so learning all these skills will make you more effective at your day job, because no matter where you work these days, thinking like an entrepreneur is critical towards not only making your company more successful and relevant, but also moving up the chain in your business. And so with that, I'm just going to wrap this section by explaining the 5 types of 10% entrepreneurs and how you actually engage as a 10% entrepreneur. If you have any questions, feel free to send them in, and then I will continue on to the 10 ways of doing this. So the first is the angel. An angel is somebody who invests their capital in exchange for ownership in a company. And the example I give here is a company called Ipsy. It's a company I invested in a couple years ago, and it is a business that sort of a YouTube commerce play where customers discover beauty. There's a community of beauty creators, and then the business sells cosmetics in a monthly glam bag. And so it's really about taking commerce into the real social arena. And the founder of that company is a good friend of mine, and I had actually worked with him on one of my earlier 10% endeavors. And when he started this, I understood the business, I understood the opportunity, I trusted him and knew that he was very strong. And I decided to invest as an angel. And we'll talk about how you actually go about that later on, but the point here is that it actually can be very impactful. So since I invested, Ipsy has gone from zero in revenue to in the hundreds of millions, and the company's done terrifically well, and the value of my investment has grown tremendously. So it has been a wonderful experience in terms of learning. I've actually been able to help them in some ways too, with bringing other investors or introducing them to companies in the industry where I had connections. But most importantly, I think for me, it's been a tremendous investment. And so it's really given me diversification away from the day job that I have. Second is the advisor. And an advisor is somebody who, instead of investing their capital for ownership in a business, they invest their money, or their time, excuse me. And the example that I love to give is about a lawyer. Since we're talking Georgetown here, I mean, probably a lot of lawyers on the line today. And lawyers are given this sort of reputation, fairly or not, of being the most risk-averse people around, right? I'm sure you've heard that if you're a lawyer. And I have a friend named Peter Barlow, who actually was reasonably a risk-taker. He left his law firm 2 times to do ventures. Entrepreneurial ventures. One was in the airline industry, one was in software, and both times those businesses actually were tremendous, spectacular implosions, and they were really quite terrible. And so he went back to the law firm and said, never again, I'm not going to do this. And so he ended up becoming a lawyer in the transportation space. But he never forgot what it meant to think like an entrepreneur, and one day he was on a plane sitting next to the founder of a company called Silver Car, which is a car rental company that operates out of airports. And the founder of Silver Car was having trouble in general raising capital, pitching the business, getting the model right. And Peter, with his legal knowledge and his knowledge of transportation and his experience working in an airline and also with some other transportation-related clients, had a lot of great ideas. And so he went in, became an advisor, where he invested his time for a stake in the business. And today, Silver Car has raised millions of dollars, tens of millions of dollars. Peter is still a lawyer. He never left. He's been an investor as well, and he's become an angel in Silver Car. And the company has become very valuable. And so Peter is this kind of amazing situation where he's had the best of both worlds. He's had the stability of his day job, the prestige of working at this great law firm, but upside he could have never expected if he had stayed at the firm. Next is the founder, and here I have a nice Georgetown example for you. Luke Holden of Luke's Lobster, a class of, I think, 2007. potentially 2008. And Luke is from Maine like me, and he was working on Wall Street at a bank, and things were going very well for him. But then on the side, he came up with the idea of starting a lobster roll chain. And he did that because he's from Maine like me, and he likes his lobster rolls, and he didn't like paying lots and lots of money to have a fancy lobster roll experience in New York City. And he understood the lobster industry. He had actually built his own boat and fished or trapped lobsters, done lobstering over the summers growing up. And so he took all of this knowledge, started a business on the side, Luke's Lobster. The first year he was fully employed at the bank, and he had a business partner help him to actually manage the thing day to day. Then he, when they opened their second store, he was able to actually leave and do this full time. And today the company has grown tremendously. He's in Japan, he's got over 20 stores in the United States, and they're going to be growing quite rapidly. So he was able to use 10% entrepreneurship to start something on the side and run it until he had enough validation that the model worked and could go do it full time. The fourth one is the aficionado, and this is somebody who's a 10% entrepreneur. And they're doing that not just for the business reasons, obviously, but also because they're going after a passion. So, for example, the example I have here is my friend Dan, who worked at Google, but invested in a restaurant on the side, and he was able to actually cook there. So he loved, you know, if you ask Dan what his passion is, he'd say cooking, and perhaps he'd even be a chef if he had no financial constraints, but the lifestyle of a chef didn't provide the stability and the financial rewards that he could get at some place like Google. And so he stayed on at Google, but he was able to act in his profession, cooking, at the level of any professional, and also become part of an endeavor that has done very well, which is this restaurant in Bogota, Colombia, La Charcutería. Finally is the 110% entrepreneur. And this is somebody who is already an entrepreneur. So this is for all of you who already have ventures. It's a great way for you to diversify. By being a 10% entrepreneur on top of your other 100, you can use all the skills that you developed as an entrepreneur, all your knowledge and network in the space, in order to help other ventures that are starting up. And you give yourself diversification and upside that you wouldn't have with that one big bet that you've made already. So you're giving yourself more. And the story I have here is an entrepreneur named Diego Saez Hill, who is the inventor of a suitcase called Blue Smart. And he came up with this idea after having merged his startup and sold it out to another startup, and he was working there and he had some stability, but it was still very much a startup, and he's very much an entrepreneur. And once you become an entrepreneur, you probably will find it impossible to stop thinking like an entrepreneur. So he came up with the idea of this suitcase, found a partner so he could continue to work full time. He and his partner developed the idea. They put it on Indiegogo with a $50,000 goal. It ended up raising $2.5 million in pre-sales, which basically showed that the model worked and that it was a great idea. He was able to join the company full-time as an entrepreneur, as CEO. He put the thing through Y Combinator. They've now raised all kinds of money, and the company is in Bloomingdale's, they're in MoMA, they're in Selfridges, they're all over the world. And I love this one because I am also an advisor and investor to BlueSmart. So this one is near and dear to my heart. With that, I'm going to just stop for 1 second to see if there's any questions. Looking here to see. And I don't see anything yet, but if you do have a question up to this point, do feel free to submit it, and Kara will share it with me. Ah, here we go. We've got one coming in here. In the example of the advisor, did you say that his investment was his time for a stake in the business? If so, could you give an example of what percent the stake in the business given for an advisor in this type of role? Great question, thank you. So it really depends, there's a range. So I'll explain to you sort of how this works. Typically what happens with an advisor is that you meet a management team and they say, we'd love to have you involved. And so then you sit down and determine how you want to actually do that. So for example, I have some companies where I'm an advisor where I give them 1 hour a month. And in that hour, you can say to yourself, well, what is that really going to do? But if you know an industry and you're well connected and you have great ideas or strategic insights, those can be fundamental to a startup team. And so one great fact or connection or anything like that from you can really move the needle for a startup. And so typically there's a range, but if you're giving say an hour a month and you're quote unquote on the advisory board of a company and you're sort of available to them if they need you, and you make some time available for them on a regular basis, that can go anywhere from 0.25% up to 1% of the company, and it vests usually over 2 years, meaning that you don't get all the stock up front, but you get it over time to make sure that you actually do what you said you're going to do. Now, there's another way to be an advisor, which is when you go in and you actually get involved in the work of the business. And so, for example, you are a lawyer and you help them out, or you're there's a great story about one of the people who was a shareholder of Facebook that had painted a mural at headquarters, and then he got paid in stock in Facebook instead of in cash, and then when Facebook went public, he became super rich. He made $200 million or something. And so with those, what you can do is figure out what is the value of the services you're providing, and then what is the value of the company today, and therefore what should the business be worth. So say it's a very early stage company, for example, and you build their website, or you come up with their marketing plan, and you think that that's worth $25,000, and you think the company, you know, this discussion with the founders is worth $1 million. You just divide 25,000 by a million, and that gets you to, you know, roughly where you should be coming out. In terms of somebody who comes in much earlier as a founder level advisor, somebody like what Peter did, where in terms of sheer hours, clearly not full-time, he was more involved. It was a very strategic, he brought in several really critical investors and management team members, and was very involved from legal standpoint. I don't know the specifics for him, but I would argue that he should receive, you know, somewhere between 1% and 5%, perhaps a little bit more if it's very early stage, and then have rights to invest in every round of capital going forward. So at the end of the day, those discussions are really negotiated in terms of the idea of how much value you can provide, how much you'll be able to do, how active you will be. But I think it's great to step back and think about, for most occasions, what is standard in the market, and then for specific ones about where you're really much more involved, what is the perceived value of both parties of what you're bringing to the table, and what is the value of your time? Thank you for that question. It was a good one. And in fact, I'm going to be posting a blog post about this in the next couple of weeks. I think we'll go forward from here. We still have plenty of time. So what I want to go through now is the 10 ways of actually doing this. And so the first one is that you need to make a plan. So 10% entrepreneurs are structured thinkers, or they try to be. And so what I actually did when I wanted to do this was I sat down and I wrote a business plan for myself. And I determined there's really three things that you need to figure out. The first is resources. What are you going to invest? The second is your investment process. How are you going to make investment decisions? And the third is your network. How are you going to leverage all the people around you to make, one, the resources count more, and two, your investment process more efficient? And so that's the first real step, is to sit down and begin writing a business plan for yourself. Because if you do that, what I found is, I talk to people who are doing this, and the people who have done all the exercises in the book, which is great, and I think it really makes a difference, obviously, as I included them, is that when they do this, it makes the whole thing much more tangible and easier to attack. So it's not that it's abstract. You're really sitting down and making a clear plan and executing against it. The second thing you'll do, and this is part of the plan, is define your resources. And so when you think about your resources as a 10% entrepreneur, there are three. The first is time. Your ability to make time to involve yourself in entrepreneurial ventures is critical. And depending on where you are in your life and your career and all sorts of other things, you may have dramatically more or less time. If you are working full-time, you have 4 children under the age of 10, and you commute an hour each way driving, your ability to do something will be very different than if you are working part-time and you have 2 days a week to yourself, and you don't have children, right? It's just, that's natural. That's fine. Either way can work, but you do need to think about how time is available to you. The second is financial capital, and that's money. What money can you actually invest? And here it comes down to the idea that you can certainly be an advisor or a founder without putting a lot of resources to work. However, you may have financial resources either now or in the future that you want to dedicate to entrepreneurship, and you must sit down and think about what you have today, what you could conceivably have in the future, and how you would like to invest those resources. The third is intellectual capital, and that's your knowledge. What are you good at? Where are your skills? Because the more that you play to the areas that you know well and leverage your skills, the more you will be likely to be successful. So it's really important to think about how you can define and understand what your intellectual capital is, and we'll talk about that in a little bit. So first of all, time. A question I get all the time, and I get it, we're all busy, and how do we make time for our 10%? So, you know, I had a funny experience. I was talking to a woman in London, and she was a friend of a friend, and we were catching up, and I was telling her about the book, and I said, you know, explaining the concept to her, and she sort of looked at me a little unclear or a little sort of incredulously and said, well, that I could never do that. I'm too busy. I'm just way too busy. And so I have said, well, what do you do? And she said, well, I'm unemployed. And so it was sort of like, it sort of didn't make sense to me, but in her mind, I think she still feels very busy, and we're all busy. I mean, I know how busy I am. I can imagine many of you are just as busy or more busy. We all have things that we could be doing. We live in a society where we have no downtime anymore, right? So how do you make time for a 10%? I mean, my first argument, and the one that I made to this the woman I was speaking to who felt that she didn't have time, is you really can't afford not to. Because if you do lose your job, for example, having a 10% to fall back on, having things you've got going on the side already, is going to be critical to you getting back on track. So number one is you really do need to realize that this is important, and it's something that you need to make time for. But that said, that's a pretty abstract concept. So how do you actually do this? The first is you leverage technology. So as I mentioned, 10 years ago there were no iPhones. Today we have an office in our pocket everywhere we go with our smartphones. And so that's really changed the game. It's flipped it on its head, and it's made it much more possible for you to be working on things on the side. You can make phone calls during your commute. You can email over the weekend. You can network and text with people. You can tweet about your business idea and get new followers. You can do all kinds of things that don't require you to do more than pull the phone out of your pocket. And that makes a big difference. And of course, things like Skype that allow you to make phone calls for nothing if you have to do something overseas. All these things, Squarespace, you can put up a website. Etsy, you can start a store. You know, I could go on for days. But it really makes a difference. And so you can use these types of things to shorten your time, to leverage and extend the time you have available to engage in 10%. The second is seeking complementarity. The more closely the things that you're doing hew to your skills, the more efficient you will be. So if you think about, for example, the things that I've done, the areas that I've done investments are with people that I know in industries I understand. So it's not like I am completely reinventing the wheel every time I do something, right? If I were to do an investment in the energy space or healthcare, which are areas that I am a complete lack of knowledge about, it would take me a lot of energy. And frankly, I just wouldn't be able to be as efficient as I can in other areas. So seeking complementarity is really important to making the most of your time. A third is cutting out the noise. So if you're like me, you've probably spent a lot of time watching and listening to podcasts and other things like that about current events, and it just sucks time out of your life. I canceled cable when I started my 10%, and I found that I didn't miss my Kardashians because I channeled that right into my 10%. And I've definitely found that the more that you focus, cut out things that are wasting your time, you can make good space that you can allocate to ventures on the side. Now, how do you think about money? So a lot of people will come to me and say, well, this sounds great, but I can't invest in these things. I just don't have the money, or I'm not sure, or it's too risky. And so all those things are fair, but also can be dealt with. The first is to set up your family office. So wealthy people, really wealthy people, have a family office, which is basically like an investment arm that invests in things in order to generate long-term returns. And while you may not be a Walton or a Bloomberg, you can certainly set aside some of your money to invest in things. And that's what I did. I took 10% of my capital and I put it into a separate account and I said, I'm going to do this. And why did I choose 10%? Because 10% is something that's meaningful. It can actually make a difference, but achievable. You don't have to vastly change your lifestyle in order to do it. And that's what I was going for when I did this. I thought about sort of the concept of a tithe, and that felt right. It's the idea of a meaningful yet achievable contribution that you can make. And in fact, what's interesting is that the average angel investor in the United States puts exactly 10% of their resources into 10% or side endeavors, angel investments. So the market also affirms that that seems like a reasonable amount. So set up that family office. Next, dig into the numbers. And this is one of these, and I have in the book a very detailed sort of tool you can use to actually figure out how much money you can invest. But I think carefully about where I spend money now. And there are certain things where I'll cut them out in order to fund my 10%. And if you think about how you spend your money, there are definitely things that you are spending money on that may not be giving you anything that you ever wanted. And so thinking about how you're spending your money and then redeploying part of that into savings so that you can have a 10% down the road is always helpful. Third, make a long-term plan. This is not necessarily something you can do right now, but it is something you'll be able to do in the future if you save. And so I have seen many people who, over time, they start small, but as time builds up and as you have some gains and wins, you reallocate those to your 10%, and it becomes a really important part of your financial picture. So it's really about thinking for the long term. I'm not a big believer in get-rich-quick schemes, and your 10% is not that. Your 10% is something that will become a meaningful part of your financial picture and your life picture going forward. Step five, assessing your third resource. We had time, we have money, now we have knowledge. So your knowledge is, what is it, it's the investment you're going to make of expertise in order to convince people to make you an advisor, or in order to launch a business as a founder that makes sense, or in order to make smart decisions as you assess angel investments. And there are three things that you can do here to think about your resources in terms of knowledge. First is to write your biography. So I had a real trouble when I started out as a 10% entrepreneur, figuring out where I should spend my time, until I sat down and wrote a biography of myself. And I sat down and I read that bio and I thought about, what are the real skills that I have built over my career and how should I leverage those into areas of focus? So rather than just doing all kinds of unrelated random stuff, I was able to come up with a couple of areas that I wanted to focus on and then network into those areas to find great opportunities and great partners and then actually go ahead and do things. So sitting down and writing a bio, it sounds like it would be easy, but this is the one people always tell me is much harder than they thought and much more valuable than they thought it might have been. And so it's a really valuable exercise that I encourage you to do, and you can find a sample of it in the book, in the back. And you can also just look at bios of people that you like online and people you respect and try to emulate what they've done. Next is to play to your strengths. So once you've figured out what you're good at, engaging in ways that leverage those areas and play to those areas will make you far more likely to succeed. And so, as I mentioned before, you're just much more efficient. There's this concept by a guy named Chris Guillebeau called flow, which is when you're sort of working and you can forget that anything else is going on. You get into your flow and you also are able to convince people much more easily why you're the right person to be doing this. Third is take calculated risks. Just because you are working within your areas of expertise doesn't mean you can't push outside of them. And so, for example, I recently made an investment in a London stage production of The Last King of Scotland, which is a book and a movie I loved. And I did so because I was able to use my finance skills to figure out if it made sense, and I was able to partner through my relationships in the UK with people who could really move the needle. And so, yes, it's a risk. It's the theater. It's probably a little crazy, because these are reasonably high-risk proposals. But I looked at this very carefully. I looked at the economics. I looked at the property, the piece, and I decided it was worth it. And so I didn't do a huge investment. We'll see how it goes. I'll see if I can learn and determine if this is something I want to do more of. But it was a great way to push myself out of my comfort zone and also do something really cool at the same time. What I learned through this experience is that you can do a lot of fun things when you're an investor in a play. You get tickets to Hamilton, and you get to meet the author of the book, and you get to go to the opening and things like that, which is, you know, that all is, it's not a strict financial return, but clearly there is a psychological return there that is significant. So once you've done all that, the next step, step number six, is to think like a venture capitalist. And when I wrote the book, what I didn't want to do was produce a book that had a really cool idea but gave you very little information on how to actually go about doing these things. And so I've worked as a venture capitalist my whole career, and I tried to distill the thinking of venture capitalists into one chapter, chapter seven, which is the longest chapter. And I try to explain how I and other people who are experienced investors make decisions. And so I focus first on two elements, which are pretty standard. So if you're not doing these as a venture capitalist, you probably don't deserve to be calling yourself a venture capitalist. And the first is assessing the business, asking a lot of questions about the business. Does it make sense? Is the industry attractive? Is this company well positioned? Do they have a differentiated model? Do they have a revenue model? Are their assumptions prudent? All those sorts of business questions. Next is about the people. Are these people who are capable of undertaking this business? Are there gaps in the team? How do you fill those gaps? Do these people share my values? All the basic questions around the alignment of interests, and are the incentives correctly structured? Things like that. And the third one, which is I like to think of as a little bit of the special sauce of the 10% entrepreneur, is about your role as a 10% entrepreneur. So it's great that the business is working, and it's great that the people are competent and ethical, but you still want to be involved in businesses where you can actually be part of creating value. You want to be able to bring a great insight or bring a client or an investor or a partnership to the table. You want to be somebody who can say, I made this company more successful than it would have been had I never come into the picture. And there's two reasons why you want to do that. The first is because that's what makes it fun and exciting. And in fact, if you're good at it, that's what will make you highly in demand, and you will see better opportunities, and you will start to partner over and over again with the great same people. And I can tell you from experience that it's the idea here is not to do a million different things with a million different people, but to find a group of people who are your tribe and do things with them over and over and over again. The second is that if you're adding value, you are also making sure that you're never forgotten in the shuffle, because entrepreneurs are busy people, and if you just send a check and never follow up with them ever again, they're not going to necessarily spend a lot of time thinking about you either. And so I really encourage people to only involve themselves in areas where they have expertise. And it's also helpful because you create a safeguard for yourself. If you don't know enough about the business and the people to be able to actually do something to help it, I would question whether you actually know enough to make a decision about whether it is a good investment. And so that has really saved me. I've gotten into any time that I've done a bad one, it's because I didn't follow rule three. And it's happened a few times, and it's never fun. But the investments I've made that are not performing are the ones where I sort of did it for momentum or for the wrong reasons, and I didn't have the ability to actually really take an active role in the company's success. Step seven, leverage your network. So your network is the thing that will make all of your investments of time, money, and knowledge work, come together and click. And so you need your network because your network allows you to find great opportunities. It allows you to conduct due diligence or actually figure out, as I mentioned before, whether a deal is good, and allows you to think like a venture capitalist. And the third one is it allows you to add value either by bringing clients or, as I like to do a lot of times, I bring in team members that can be helpful. So I find some person who may be looking to be a 10% entrepreneur, and I find them an opportunity to connect with an exciting company. And so your network, what I did and what I recommend you do is really sit down, leverage technology, go through LinkedIn, download all your contacts from your address book, and then sit down and go through and think about who are the people that you know that can put you in business, who can help you find projects, who's doing this already, who's part of an angel investment group and maybe could get you involved in that, who needs your help, Who are the people who can teach you? All of these sorts of things. It's exactly what I've done, and I know people do it too, because, for example, I have lots of friends from Georgetown that ask me out to coffee and ask me how to get in the business of being a 10% entrepreneur, and that's exactly what you need to do. And so obviously I just tell them to buy the book, because everything's in there. But I also look for opportunities to help them out, and they do the same for me. And so leverage your Georgetown network, leverage your professional network, leverage your friends, leverage the people that you meet on soccer game on Saturday morning or at the dinner party on Tuesday night. All of those people will help you put you in business as a 10% entrepreneur and will help make all of your investments and resources far more impactful. Step 8. Put your day job first and act with integrity. Really, the point here is that as 10% entrepreneurs, we must appreciate the fact that it is our day job that allows us to succeed. And so I always encourage people who are 10% entrepreneurs to actually spend time thinking about how to make sure that they don't do anything that would be problematic for their day job. Make sure you understand the rules. And I encourage people to be very open about what they're doing. And in fact, if you think about Luke from Luke's Lobster, many of his early clients were his colleagues at the bank. I mean, these people, they got it. They were supportive of him, and I think that's a really great way to do things if you can be open. You don't necessarily need to wear your startup's t-shirt around the office. I mean, there's no reason to do that per se, but it is good to be open, and obviously never ever play in the gray areas. Corporate resources at your day job are not to be used for your 10%. You're just asking yourself for trouble, and you're imperiling all the rest of us who are respecting those rules. Step 9, build a long-term strategy. So, as I mentioned, this is not a get-rich-quick scheme. The typical entrepreneurial venture takes 7 years to go from its first financing event to its exit and for people to get paid out. So this is not something you're going to just, you know, do overnight. And you don't just have to do startups, right? You can do real estate. You can do a restaurant. You can do all kinds of different things. And it's great to mix them because, for example, I've done several real estate transactions. I've done a bunch of startups, and I've done a play. All of those have very different risk profiles. They're all got different abilities of generating cash. And so the real estate generates short-term cash and dividends. The startups are the upside. But all of them come together to give me a long-term strategy that makes sense for me. And the great thing is you never have to retire from being a 10% entrepreneur. And there's a great story in the book of a guy named Steve Siegel, who is the head of brokerage at CBRE in New York City. And he's been a 10% entrepreneur for nearly half a century. He's been investing in buildings, and he's an investor in PJ Clark's, the restaurant chain. He's an investor in a minor league baseball team. He's an investor in just about everything. And he's never quit his job because he loves his day job, and it gives him the network and the capital to do all of his 10%. But he also knows that if he ever retires, he'll still have a flourishing portfolio of 10% that he can manage and be involved with, and it'll keep him sharp and connected and engaged with the world around him. And finally, this is all about mindset. So the funny thing about this strategy is that people still tell me, like, oh, I can't do that. It's too risky, or I don't have time, I don't have money, I don't know anybody, how do I do this? And I understand when you're doing something new, it's hard, but here's the thing, it's just 10%. There's nothing, you cannot upset the apple cart with just 10%. It's a great starting place. And even if you fail, it's an experiment rather than a failure, right? I mean, so much of entrepreneurship is about taking small chances and learning from them. And that's really what you're doing here. And if things work out, you can crank it up. There are people who I know who started out at 10%, went to 50%, went to 100%. There's a woman named Dipali Patwa who started a company called Masala Baby, which is a really awesome children's apparel company based out of Brooklyn. And she was working in fashion, doing home furnishings like bedspreads and things like that for big brands, and traveling the world, dealing with all of her clients and all of the suppliers. And then on the side, she's from India, she got the idea of launching a children's clothing brand. Made a very small investment of $5,000, started this thing. Then Matthew McConaughey's son was spotted out wearing her stuff. Things went crazy. She's now in all kinds of different places. She was running the business out of her basement. And so she ended up getting getting to a point where she needed more time for Masala Baby. So she gave her 50% of her time. She got a job that allowed her to do 50-50. And now, 5 years later, now that things have been proven out, the business is flourishing and she can afford to do it, she runs Masala Baby full-time and she is now the CEO of her own company. But she's done it in a way that she's really minimized the risk. And so she knows going in, before she jumps in, that she's actually got a business that's going to be successful, that she can invest in, and she's done it in a really smart way. And what's so interesting is if you think about stats, there was a great study that came out of the University of Wisconsin. It showed that people who start ventures on the side before jumping in full-time are 50% more likely to succeed than people that jump in straight away. Why is that? Well, if you were a finance major, it's because of a real option theory, the idea that you, when you do this, you can wait until the option is in the money before jumping. But in a more fundamental sense, the way I think about it is when you quit your job and start an entrepreneurial venture, you start a clock on yourself. You basically say, I've got X amount of savings and I can survive for X amount of months until I'm out. And I can, you know, in that point of time, I've got to get either make enough money, get enough traction, or to either raise money or bootstrap this and fund myself. And so you put a tremendous amount of pressure on yourself and on the business model to succeed in this given amount of time. And as I learned from a great professor of mine, a guy named Bill Solomon at Harvard Business School, entrepreneurs are optimistic, and it usually takes double the time and double the money to get where they want to go. And so if you put pressure on yourself and you have this runway that is vastly runway that does decline over time, you're giving yourself a really tough situation. And so that is why I encourage you to think about this in an incremental way and about mindset. I would say don't be afraid. It's a small bet that could pay off big for you. And with that, we got about 8 minutes left, and I've got here my contact information, so do feel free to reach out to me. I'm more than happy to hear from you, and I would, again, encourage you to go ahead and take a look at the site and check out the information there, and feel free to be in touch if you have questions. Thank you.
Patrick, thank you so much. Fantastic presentation. I will give everyone a moment to jot down some of what you're seeing on the screen. But I did also want to go ahead and get started with our Q&A. So Patrick, we have a few questions coming in, and I've been filtering some of these out and sending them over to you. But I'll go ahead and get started with the first, which is, how can you be sure when the right time is to invest in a startup?
It's a good question. So it depends on, I think for me, it depends on your level of risk tolerance. The earlier you go, the higher opportunity you have, because the valuation of the company is so much lower. And so either as an advisor or an investor, you just get more the earlier you go. But of course, without, you know, where there is reward, there is risk. And so what I like to think about is I like to diversify. And so I have some businesses where I've invested very early on because I knew the people and I felt comfortable with the risk I was taking. And I recognized that if I lost the money, I was a smaller amount that I might put in with something that's a little bit more established. But I think, you know, the rules of thumb are, A, never invest money that you cannot afford to lose. And that's with any investment of this nature. B, make sure that the risk and reward relationship is acceptable to you. And C, if it's too early and you just feel like it's a little too risky to do it, I encourage people to then become an advisor, learn more about the company, and then when you have more knowledge, you may feel more comfortable becoming an investor as well. And I love to combine the advisor and the investor together. I think it's a great way of having a greater impact but also enhancing your returns.
Great, Patrick, thank you so much. We have other questions coming through and I've sent them over to you. The next
okay.
one, just if it's easier, whichever's easiest for you, but this one asking, if you're looking to be an advisor or an investor, what is the best way to connect with startups? And I'll let you go ahead and
Right. I got it. Now I'm seeing these questions. Sorry about that. So I get this question all the time, and it's a totally legitimate question, especially if you don't you don't see a lot of entrepreneurs. And the answer is you must go to where the entrepreneurs are. So how do you get to where the entrepreneurs are? Number one, go to events. There's so many networking events all over the place that you can find. Go to meetup.com. If you live in New York City, go to Gary's Guide. So you can find people there. Become a mentor at an accelerator, or join an angel investment group. All those ways, all those things can allow you to do this. There are online platforms. I'm not a super big fan of these online platforms because I think it's hard for you to actually, you can't meet the people. It's much more hands-off. It's sort of like playing a video game, which I think is imprudent when it comes to spending your money. But some people feel very strongly they are great ways to do it. But it's just about getting out there into the world. It's very hard to execute this strategy from your living room. So think about all the things, all the places where you can meet entrepreneurs, and then talk to people. Ask all your classmates. It's really, this is a networking game at the end of the day. Next, as a stakeholder in a company, how do you protect yourself from lawsuits? Do you need insurance coverage? No, these companies should be limited liability or corporations. So you're a shareholder. There's no, unless you personally do something that that breaches the corporate veil, you are, you know, corporate law protects you from personal liability. So don't need to worry about that. But I do think this begs another question: is how do you do you need a lawyer? How do you make sure that things are appropriately papered? And one thing you want to never do, and I see this all the time, I just saw it yesterday with a friend of mine who got totally rocked, is didn't have an agreement. It was a handshake agreement, and that's great early on, but the problem is the minute when a company's not worth anything, nobody cares, right? They're happy to go on a handshake. The minute it's worth something, all of a sudden everybody remembers a different version of history, and they remember how much more value they created than they said they did, or whatever. And so you really want to put everything down on paper. It's really critical, and it also preserves relationships, because the worst thing you want to have is a fight over money with your partners when things are going well. Okay. Another, are there worthwhile investments that can be done for something like $25K? What is a typical amount to invest? Great question. So there's a great story about the investor in Twitter, Dick Costolo. He later became CEO because his 10% turned into 100. And this guy sold his company to Google, so he's pretty liquid. And he was offered, how much you want to invest, Dick? 50, 100K? He said, this is very early stage. 25K is enough for me. And he's ended up making millions of dollars because Twitter, when it went public, was at a huge valuation. The reason I love that story is because sometimes we think that you need to be a millionaire to do this. You don't. And you can start as little as a couple thousand dollars. I've seen people, my smallest investment was $5K in a business. I put much more than that, but in other ones, but $5K is you can find things for $5K. 25, I'd say, is pretty standard. And if an entrepreneur says that 25 is too little for them, I think feel free to push back. I feel like, especially for early stage, 25 is absolutely doable and fair and standard. And lots of people do those kinds of investments. But you can also see if you can do less. I did one where the minimum was 25, and I at the time was just not sure about it, and so I got them to do a little bit lower. So it's really up to you having the comfort, I would say, to push back and say, no, 25 is a little bit much for me. If you really want me to be an investor, if you think I can help you, if you think that this is a good fit, why don't we do something a little lower? And if they say no, that's fine. Then maybe they're not the right people for you, but I bet they won't. Georgetown proximity. What are the challenges a 10% entrepreneur faces? Oh, geographic proximity. How do you deal with geographic proximity? So obviously leveraging technology is really critical, and there are people making investments. I have a number of investments in Latin America, so I clearly have no fear of going cross-border. And I think that, international distance is the meaning, right? So I've done, most of my deals are international in nature. What I think is really critical in terms of geographic proximity is having, again, a team that sees value in you being there. Because the biggest risk, I would say, with the geographic question is that people will be like, forget about you or not call you back, or somehow you'll be left out of the picture. And that you don't want. And so as a result, you want to make sure that you take that into account. And with that, it is 1:30. I will answer one more if Kara is okay with it. Do you have advice on certain attributes of a founder entrepreneur? Okay, what are the attributes I look for when I'm looking investing in their deal? Very good question. So for me, what I have noticed, now having done over 20 investments in my career, what I have noticed are the ones that work out versus the ones that don't. Number one is they understand, they have industry experience. So it's not just having a lot of passion. Passion is obviously necessary, but it's not sufficient. Having real industry expertise and credibility is number one. Number two is having patience and the ability to take criticism. Number three is having real commitment to the business and financial commitment. Like anybody who's an entrepreneur and wants to charge $150,000 a year salary, you don't want to be there. I've seen that before. You know, these people need to have a strong incentive to create value, and that's really important. And you also want to find people who are respectful and who are going to be good people to know, because life's too short to do business with people that you don't like. I just won't do it. And in fact, I find that my 10%, they just make me, you know, a much happier person, because I've got great people around me who teach me. And so if somebody's a jerk, yeah, life's too short. Final question, silly follow-up from Court Dwyer from the State of Maine. Hey, Court, I'm going to be there soon. Who is it with Luke Holden in the picture? It's not Nate Chapnick. It is it's his business partner, Ben Conniff. So Ben actually wrote they have a great cookbook out, which if you haven't picked it up, I recommend you do, about how to cook like a Mainer, and it's pretty awesome. And I encourage you all to eat as many Luke's lobsters as you can. I like to have one a week minimum. Okay, and with that, I think we're done. So thank you so much. You've got my information. I love being part of the Georgetown community this way, and I wish you all the best of luck. Lots of Hoya Saxa. Keep me posted if you do this and have success, which I know you will. I want to hear about it.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Patrick. Thank you for giving your time to Georgetown again, and to remind everyone to get in touch with Patrick and all of the ways that he's listed here. And we're also going to be sending out recording of this presentation so you can reference it as many times as you need. But be sure to go out and grab a copy of his book. Patrick, thank you so much, and hopefully we will see you on campus soon. Take care, everyone. Bye-bye.